translation, he called her a prostitute, one that giving their body to another. So what he says in this chapter, God raises up and says, I realize that a lot of you that have gotten saved, I want you to hear this. You've gotten saved, but you're still tied to other stuff. And the only way you can get untied is that I unite you with somebody that is not bound to come in the covenant with you and pull you out of your bondage. So he says, I want you to take this whore, this prostitute, and what I want us to do today is put it in the text that what are you tied to? Now, if, like I said last week, I made a comment, and I did it to frustrate people that were overweight. And it was not to hurt you, but it was to help you to realize that there's something in all of us that will respond when we feel like our feelings or our self is being attacked. When we get on the defense. We're not, by our own nature, willing to expose ourselves. By nature, when we're not redemptive, we do the same way Adam and Eve do. When we find out that something is wrong with us, we get something artificial and sew it around us to cover us up. And from Genesis to Revelation, from the second chapter all the way to the end of Revelations, God is trying to unclothe us so that he can get in and detach us from stuff that has attached to our life from our childhood. Now, my battle is rejection. And I have to know that that is my area of weakness. So what God does, he shapes my company and the people around me to help identify rejection so that not that I can clothe myself, so that I can see the demonic forces and how it entangles in my life and hinders who I'm supposed to be because God wants to make me more better. So what God will do, the very thing that you hate, he will attach to you. The very thing that you're bound with, you'll place in your life. That's why some of y'all married the thing that you hate. If you hate the fact that your father abandoned you, you'll marry somebody that will abandon you. And if you don't get free, hear me, if you don't get free, you'll live your life trying to compensate and overcompensate to keep the present person in your life from leaving you because you live in the fear of your father leaving you, and now you got another man in your house and you're afraid he's going to leave you, so you go overboard to keep him. So God says to Hosea, he says, I want you to marry the harlot. And I want that harlot to come in the covenant with you just the way she is. Somebody said, he knew it was a harlot when he married her. So what comes with a harlot? What comes with a prostitute? God knew what you were when he brought you into the kingdom of God. He knew you were jacked up from the neck up. He knew you would have idols, and he knew that you would wander off. He knew that you would do all of those things. He knew that when he did you, but he did it, and he placed the person of the Holy Spirit so you couldn't stay like that. So I want you to know right now, you ain't okay. We can turn around 3 times, jump up, slap ourselves, pour oil on us. The reality is we just entered into the season of the apothecary. And what the season of the apothecary is the season to die. Because if you don't die, you're going to kill somebody. You're going to kill your kids. You're going to kill your husband. You're going to kill your mama. You're going to hit the drugstore. You're going to kill somebody because your death, not brought on to captivity, can kill. That's why the word of God says we must die. I am crucified with, nevertheless I live, not me, but Christ. So the more he lives in us, the Bible says we reckon ourselves dead. In other words, we're becoming disentangled from the spirit of whoredom and prostitution. Because the flesh will do anything for a thrill. Ooh, Jesus is quiet in here. So the very thing you don't need, God says, marry it. And when you marry them, listen to what happened. He said, marry her. And guess what happens? After Hosea in the second chapter, because I don't want to give y'all a lot of scripture because y'all will be bored. After the second chapter, he tells them, he comes to the Lord, he marries her, and guess what she does? She goes back to her lovers. Now she's in covenant with God, and she's still smoking weed. She's still lying and cheating. She's still sneaking out at night. She still won't come to God. She still won't change. She's still as angry as she can be. She's still as toxic as can be. He said, but what do I do? You told me to marry her. Look at somebody say, you told me to marry the hoe.
You told me to marry the hoe.
I married the hoe. Now, let me tell you what that hoe is. That very thing that stops you from being who you need to be in Christ. It ain't a person. It's a behavior. It's an ungodly belief. It's a spirit, soul, hurt. It's something, you know what? The Bible says it's easier to win a city than to help somebody with a wounded spirit. It's a mama that dropped you. It's an aunt that crippled you. It's somebody that didn't handle you right. Somebody that abandoned you and somebody that rejected you has now attached to your life. And everywhere you go, when you look in the face of other people, you see that rejection. So you have become entangled. And when the pressure is on with you and the sweet Savior Jesus Christ, and you just can't seem to measure up and feel like you can never be holy and you can never go into the holy place and you can never worship, you can never spend time with God, where do you go? You go back to your whore. Go back to your stuff. People say, as long as I'm reading the word, as long as I'm praying, I'm okay. But the minute I put the Bible down, my mind going to wondering, way back yonder time when I was with somebody and all of that takes me. Why? Because there is something that has to happen to break that soul tie. Sometimes people are tied to one person because the Bible says when you lie with a whore, you become one. And this is not biblical. Scientists, you can get this on the internet. This ain't nothing out the scriptures. But whoever you lay with, you have their spirit. So when you come into those relationships where you break your hymen, you enter into a blood covenant. Can we talk? Great. Because there's a tissue that's protect the place where you can begin to merge emotionally. Okay, you don't marry that person. You find somebody else because, you know, people believe in trying the package before you buy. Well, then now, you know, God has forgiven you. He's saved you. He's changed you. But you got all these people still in your soul. And the council, when you go to council for marriage council, they don't even deal with soul, spirit, soul, ungodly beliefs, and soul ties. So that's the person you tied to. You never untied with them, and you tied with somebody now that you're walking down the altar, got some papers, You get married, you think.